welcome back to the show, folks. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now your time. Our number is 0800 723 465, and we're going to go to the lines now and take our first call from Sterling. Sterling, how are you, mate?
Good, good. I did the Coast to Coast about 20 years ago. I'm about 40 now, and I did, And Robyn was a bit of an inspiration at the time. And what I'd like to say, like...
So when you say at the time, is he not an inspiration anymore?
Watch it, Sterling. Watch it, that Mike King. He tries to put words in your mouth. Sterling, I'm very impressed. You did the event 20 years ago. I'm very impressed.
Yeah.
And did you enjoy it?
Oh, totally. I took it an idiot's point of view. I thought it was a bit of a picnic, you know, and I took my cat lunch, and I didn't realise it was competitive at the time.
You went for a picnic.
You took your cut lunch. Did you actually walk into the mountains, into the mountain section with a cut lunch?
And a rug.
Not the rug. I'm sure you didn't take the rug, but you took your cut lunch with you?
I had one of those hats that, like an umbrella on the top, and I stopped and ate it while people were running past me. I thought, well, you're in such a rush.
Are you going to do it again? Coast to coast, I mean.
Okay, this is 20 years later, and now I've got new challenges.
Oh, hard,
yeah,
no.
Yeah, no.
Well, exactly, that's where I am.
Hey, look, one of the reasons that I put together the Spades Coast to Coast in the first place was to give people the opportunity to do something that they hadn't done before, but then there was always the hope that they would go on from that to do things like climbing Mount Cook or kayaking across Cook Strait or cycling the length of New Zealand or walking the length of New Zealand.
I'm just saying, okay, I'm 20 years older now, and that inspiration by doing that, by having something like that to look forward to and actually do something, and doing that has made me, like, since then, I've got, like, I went and did a commerce degree. Sorry, Robyn, I did a commerce degree, and I don't think I would have done it if I hadn't done that.
Thanks for your call, Sterling. Out there is a great way of describing you, and we've got a question here for you on the Facebook. Good to hear someone that uses good humour to get through his life, and I too live by the credo, laughter is the best medicine. How much of your humour is a self-defence mechanism to allay situations you encounter that have an effect on you, be it internalised trauma or externalised trauma?
You mean when you're in dire straits? No, I don't use humour at that point. I'm trying to think my way out of the situation.
As your sense of humour is full on, I imagine that your temper would be...
It's catastrophic. Absolutely catastrophic. And, it's not a pretty thing at all. And it is counterproductive. Okay, and I recognise that. It's counterproductive. But sometimes I'm just not an excuse, but sometimes you have to let off steam.
Yeah.
Now, in the 70s, they talked about having rooms where you could go in and you could punch a punch ball, whatever the hell they called it. There is something that does occur, though, for me, and it occurs frequently enough for me to mention it, and that is that when things become very, very difficult and very, very stressful, I have complete out-of-body experience. It is extraordinary. Okay. And because it happens, I now appreciate it.
Mm.
And I look upon it as a guardian angel.
Yep.
And where I actually sit, I stand above myself and I look down on myself as I'm doing this.
Yeah.
And it has a very, very calming effect upon me.
What you describe in terms of the out-of-body thing, is that because you describe it being in a situation where it's helpful.
Yes, yes.
Is it ever also something that happens when it's not necessarily helpful? Because I think what you describe, depersonalization, out-of-body experiences, for many people is a helpful thing, but sometimes it also happens unpredictably, so people kind of can't control it and it's not necessarily helpful.
Oh, I don't for experience
you,
that. So
no,
I
don't, you don't.
No.
So for you, no, it's no, mine is always high, it's a stress situation way of coping.
The stress levels are unbelievable at times.
So how do you cope with other people's unhappiness if you've got...
I'm not that great at it.
You know,
if they're unhappy with me?
Well,
I'm not a good one. I don't cope well. I mean, if people criticise me, I take it terribly badly.
0800 723 465 is our number. How are you, Lou?
Oh, yeah, I'm really good, thanks. I've just tuned into the show a couple of weeks ago, and it's really interesting to see how many nut bars there are out there and all the different...
Have you met our new leader? His name's Robyn.
Robyn.
Robyn Judkins is our new messiah of nutters. Ah! Ah!
But all the different medication that doctors put you on,
mm-hmm.
it's just insane. I was diagnosed with VKH, Voigt-Koehn-Nagel syndrome, where the pupils stick to your iris, so there's too many white cells in your eyes.
Oh, what?
Yeah, totally. And then through that, I had front lobe epilepsy.
What?
Bipolar. I had lumbar punctures. I was on anti-epilum. All this huge amount of different medication. And left town and everything, came to a new city, and was told I didn't even have bipolar.
Oh, right, okay. Right, obviously, well, it's a different town. different
insane.
Doctor. Yeah,
insane.
No, isn't that amazing?
I've got 5 years of record from the hospital,
yeah.
and yet apparently none of it's even relevant.
Well, maybe it isn't now either, because things do change, and your whole... I mean, I'm not a doctor. I'm probably the last person to be counselling anybody on this sort of stuff. But your circumstances do change as well, and that can make a huge difference to your life and what's going on in it. And, you know, just the fact that you moved town is probably the best damn thing you ever bloody did.
You know what? I think you're right.
Well, I'm thinking of becoming a doctor. At the moment, I've been sitting opposite David, who's been pretending to be a doctor for years, and he wears white, and I wear black. And so, obviously, there's a huge dichotomy. I like to use, by the way, very large words, which I'm not sure of the meaning of. But dichotomy is a cracker. So I suggest to you that when you move to your next new town, if you use the word dichotomy, within a fraction of a nano of a nanosecond, you'll have a new car.
I'm not moving now.
See what I mean?
I'm
not being facetious. I really do think that you know that old axiom, a change is as good as a holiday. Well, it really is, you know. I mean, I still think it's one of the nicest things you can ever offer anybody is a change in their circumstances. And if anybody ever comes to you and needs a bit of help at any time, you just remember this, that you can give them something else to do, take them to a movie, go somewhere else with them, take them on a holiday, take them away for a couple of hours, you'll change their lives.
That was absolutely sterling advice from our new doctor, Mr.
Ravi.
Judkins.
Ravi.
You're Ravi Judkins.
Ravi Judkins.
No, Ravi J.
Any final words of advice for our nutty listeners?
Well, don't call me.
And that is bloody good advice. Robyn, thanks very much for joining us here. David, as always, see you again next week.
Yeah, see you next week.
Good night from the Nutters Club.
If you wish to speak to someone about an issue raised in this program, you can find contact information at our website. New Zealand On Air, looking after nuts like me since 2009.